We'll have about a bit short of 90 minutes to go through the session. What I'd like to do is make sure that we focus on the subject of this session, so that we don't sort of spill over on the and take over the other topics that we'll be looking at later on. I think with the remarks that we heard both from Nicholas Imbodin and Ambassador Yu, we have a very good framework of discussion for what follows. The idea here is to look into what we have called consolidating the multilateral trade system, look past to recent developments there, and then what's coming as we move into as we move in the post-Nairobi mode and into possibly the next ministerial or MC11 already, which seems to be the framework of reference now for talks in the WTO. We have a really excellent panel of people with great knowledge on these issues. You have the speakers' biographies with you. They are here mostly representing their think tanks, with the exception of Stuart, who is an old hand on these matters and a very wise commentator on trade issues these days. So we have with us Dennis Noer, who is the president of the Kiel Institute for the World Economy in Germany. Ambassador Bosco Aran, director of the TEPAF Center for Multilateral Trade Studies in Ankara. Ronald Saborio, who has recently joined Ideas Center as a senior partner. Jean-Pierre Clément, who is emeritus professor of MIT and known here as the founder of the Evian Group, as well as Stuart Harbinson, who, as I said before, is acting independently. So let's start with Dennis Norwood, and what I'd like to ask panelists is to give us 10 minutes or so of their thoughts, and then I'll see whether we immediately interact with the audience or whether we leave this for a questions and answers session. I will also not add from my part at this time, but rather interact with the panelists during the session, and perhaps at the end of the session to make some remarks. So I'll start with Dennis Noer to lead the way. Dennis, please.
Good. It's a pleasure and honor to be here, and I'd like to congratulate the conference organizers for putting together a wonderful series of conferences and workshops culminating in this one. Today I'd like to talk about two issues. One is how we could think about promoting, bringing momentum into the multilateral trade negotiations, and what role the G20 can play in this process. So far, the G20 has not played a major role in reforming the world trading system, but the time has come, in my judgment, that this could change, that the G20 could be far more active in this regard. And the reason is that the G20 now has the opportunity to promote not only coherence among the plethora of different trade agreements, but also make these agreements more sustainable and inclusive. And two developments have made a strong case for G20 involvement in this area. The first development is, as we know and as we've heard, this proliferation of bilateral and regional and plurilateral trade agreements. And the second is the development of the Sustainable Development Goals that has been agreed last year. So the proliferation of trade agreements outside the WTO is well known, from, say, the Trans-Pacific Partnership to the Transatlantic Trade and Investment Partnership, extending to plurilateral agreements such as the Trade and Services Agreement. And these agreements, though unambiguously useful in their own right, have weakened the WTO and have made it much more difficult to achieve coherence among trade agreements, amplifying the danger of serious trade distortions. In addition, and this should give us hope, the Sustainable Development Goal number 17, to strengthen the means and implementation and revitalize the Global Partnership for Sustainable Development, includes the following important passage on trade, quote, to promote a universal, rule-based, open, non-discriminatory, and equitable multilateral trading system under the World Trade Organization, including through the conclusion of negotiations under its Doha Development Agenda. And secondly, realize timely implementation of duty-free, quota-free market access on a lasting basis for all least developed countries consistent with the World Trade Organization decisions, including by ensuring that preferential rules of origin applicable to imports from least developed countries are transparent and simple and contribute to facilitating market access. I've left out sort of one sentence in between. But this is really significant, I believe, because it brings the Sustainable Development Goals and the role of the G20 with regard to trade negotiations onto one common footing. So the door is open for the G20 to promote the WTO as the central negotiation forum for tying together other trade agreements through various different channels, including centralized dispute settlement. Now, China's G20 presidency sets an excellent framework for establishing a significant G20 role in this domain. This framework is classified in terms, as we know, of the four I's, each of which has important implications for the reform of the world trading system. First, this is not exactly the right order, innovative, and this enables us to focus on new aspects of trade negotiations, including those concerning the new digital age and green innovation, as well as cybersecurity. Invigorated, this encourages us to think about the global financial system and other forms of global governance, which have an immediate bearing on the functioning of the world trading system. And what's clear is that these different forms of governance need to be designed co-jointly so as not to create even more noise in our international governance systems. Interconnected, this obviously focuses directly on the promotion of trade and investment as well as the reform of world trade institutions, so central to our topic here. And inclusive, that encourages us to think of reforms of the world trading system that are consistent with the Sustainable Development Goals as well as other international agreements such as COP21 negotiated in Paris last year. So these four I's and the SDGs with regard to trade and development set a framework for thinking about the reform of the world trading system as part of a larger overarching effort creating coherence in global governance. And my favorite way of thinking about these is in terms of three overriding objectives for such an overarching enterprise, illustrated here through a triangle of objectives. And the triangle pictures the three major objectives of global governance. One is prosperity, including both material and non-material prosperity. environmental viability on this side, and inclusiveness is the last part of the triangle. And all G20 initiatives, I believe, should be placed within this triangle, since certainly each of the four I's is easily locatable within this triangle, as the figure illustrates. So what I'd like to do now is spell out some concrete implications of this framework of thought. One concerns the coherence of global governance with regards to the WTO. Clearly, coherence and consistency among trade agreements is essential for achieving prosperity, environmental viability, and inclusiveness. And the G20, I believe, should play a proactive role in therefore strengthening the WTO in trade negotiations. And this can be done, for example, as we've heard, in the G20 newly founded Trade and Investment Working Group. I believe personally that this will inevitably may involve some reform of the WTO itself. There's been a lot of talk about the single undertaking principle, for example, whereby every item of a negotiation is part of an indivisible package so that no part of it can be agreed unless all of it is agreed. This strikes many people as not a particularly promising basis for negotiating trade deals in this day and age because of its ambiguous implications for such issues as local content requirements in this new digital age where goods and services are often bundled together in ways that are difficult to pull apart. But a reformed WTO could play a very important role in establishing guidelines for the coordination of negotiations at different levels, bilateral, regional, plurilateral. And of course, this has big implications for this huge wave of technological changes that is coming our way, called the new digital age or the fourth industrial revolution or whatever you want to call it, including big data, cloud computing, Internet of Things, etc., etc. It's coming, it's on its way in both developed and developing countries, and it is going to change the ground rules in which the world trading system operates, and therefore we will need to rethink. The G20, I believe, has a very important role in such a rethink. For example, there's an urgent need to establish a world digital trade agreement, in my opinion, to set global rules for the electronic transmission of data and related services, as well as internet-enabled trade. Such an agreement would make new technologies more likely to be prosperity-enhancing and employment-enhancing, a big worry with the advance of productivity of machines relative to unskilled labor. This agreement would have a major role to play in defining intellectual property, regulating customer protection on the internet, shaping intermediary liability, establishing international consistent methods of dispute settlement. It should vouchsafe a free flow of data around the world, subject to well-defined exceptions involving matters such as protection of privacy of personal data. Now, in view of the potential that these new technologies have, in particular, for small and medium-sized enterprises, such an agreement could also play a major role in permitting the creation of digital platforms for SMEs to provide their goods and services worldwide, with internet-enabled sources of finance and coherent rules on customs and border compliance. Such an agreement could also play a major role in providing access to knowledge and basic science and technology around the world. I believe these are really important issues, and the world is changing in ways that are fundamental and directly relevant to WTO negotiations as a centralizing framework. Because we now live in a world in which data is collected in one country. It's aggregated with data from another country, and that is analyzed in a third country. Now, that has huge implications for trade negotiations. The opportunities for SMEs to reduce trade costs, give SMEs online presence, is extraordinary. A recent study shows that 95% of SMEs in the United States using eBay with regard to their customers are present in more than four countries, compared to less than 5% for those who operate offline. So this is changing the way trade works in a dramatic way, particularly for the SMEs. It also offers extraordinary opportunities for developing countries, particularly with regard to access to finance, crowdfunding platforms that are already available in Brazil and Colombia and elsewhere. But there are tricky issues, some concerning the importance of services trade that is changed dramatically in its nature due to these new technologies. First of all, obviously, increasing opportunities for trade and services. Think of legal, engineering, and financial services that can easily flow electronically through the internet. But then there is a very serious issue of the blurring of the distinction between goods and services. You know, if you think, software used to be distributed via CDs. Now, these CDs were goods, and they clearly fell under the General Agreement on Tariffs and Trade. But now they are delivered online, just as are books, films, music. And now they become services. Same thing, but what was a good now becomes a service, and there the General Agreement trade and services becomes relevant. These agreements do not overlap. There are differences in, for example, implications on the collection of customs duties. Then, to make matters even more complicated, services have become parts of goods to a degree that hasn't been dreamt of before. The so-called digital wrappers, sensors attached to goods. So the distinction between goods and services is no longer clear. And then there's the issue of privacy. There are important differences in privacy regulation. And as long as these differences persist, then exporting countries will have an incentive to impose restrictions on the movement of personal data. For example, we have seen that the EU Privacy Directive prohibits transfers of data to countries that do not offer adequate levels of protection. So there is a huge set of issues that need to be tackled and tackled quickly, and I believe the WTO is a good place to do so. So in summary, the G20 could help revive global trade through an invigoration of the world trading system, with the WTO playing a central reformed role in global trade governance. Through its broad membership, I believe the G20 also has an important role to play in ensuring that such a reorganization or reinvigoration of the world trading system goes hand in hand with the pursuit of sustainable development goals, as well as international climate agreement and others. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dennis. Let me move immediately forward to Ambassador Adam.
Okay, thank you so much, sir. Well, I mean, thank you for giving me 72 minutes to complete my remarks. First, it is indeed a great pleasure and honor for me to participate in this prestigious event. Thank you for thank you for giving me the chance to convey my views on the shaping of the new geography of trade. Please allow me to mention one of my proudest assignments bestowed on me during my diplomatic career had been to be the permanent representative of Turkey to the World Trade Organization from 2007 to 2012. Since then, I always felt I felt obliged to continue to follow what WTO was doing. Frankly, to follow the developments in WTO had been an easy task for me. Simply, so few achievements. The last two ministerial conferences recorded meager results and barely managed to keep the WTO alive. The question of centrality of WTO has become a prevailing question. And who lost? Why WTO was lost? And of course, who to blame? The trade negotiators, the WTO secretariat, or the decision-making process of the WTO? My fellow negotiators cannot be blamed. Simply, they followed the instructions of their own governments. The WTO secretariat is known as the most sophisticated international civil servants among all the international organizations. And of course, the WTO is a member-driven organization, and the secretariat is there just to assist the negotiators in their work. When the scholars put the blame on the decision-making process, they should be reminded right away what we as a trade negotiators work on are legally binding documents. In other words, every trade negotiator daily deal with the issues that directly involve with their country's national sovereignty. The process takes time because the legally binding nature of the documents produced at the WTO. However, life does not wait for the WTO to catch up. The profound changes brought about by the technological breakthroughs, as was mentioned by Professor Snower, necessitate new rules that regulate the international trade. Shall we continue to rely on the existing rules to govern the trade system of today? So we are confronted with a dilemma: how to keep the existing system and confront the need to mold new rules. No country and no multilateral organization could have the luxury to ignore the challenges facing the rule-based trade issues and the developments that jeopardize the very essence of the Bretton Woods system, particularly at a time when the protectionist measures are implemented persistently disguised under various schemes. The Bretton Woods system that's supposed to be the main governing body of global trade, global rule-based trade and investment scheme is argued to lose its centrality, of course. The requests of TTB, TTIP, and RCEP could be considered as an indication of the possible fragmentation of the system that till now has provided an acceptable level of stability. And the main drivers of all those three major mega deals are EU, US, and China. So very prominent members. And in WTO, the P5. The permanent five, if you include Brazil and China, Brazil and India to it, becomes the main driver of the whole system. So of the five, three are engaged in a different mega deal system. The winds of change are blowing strongly in the horizon of global trade. Let us try to identify the most salient reasons why this is taking place. For almost a quarter of a century, the streamlining of global trade by the Bretton Woods institutions has been ineffective. The Doha development round has yielded only meager results. The growth of the Bretton Woods institutions has not kept pace with the growth of the global economy. The level of protectionism still matters, despite all pledges in G20 meetings to scale it down. At the same time, the inherent complexities of today's world needs substantial fine-tuning to the existing rules to maintain a functioning system. The synergy created by the industrialized countries has become insufficient to mold new rules. In the WTO energy agenda, the developing and emerging economies' main concern is to correct the asymmetries incorporated in the Bretton Woods system. The crisis of 2008
has accelerated the dispersion of economic power, thus making the pressure for emerging economies more visible and assertive. In 2012, a milestone was passed with the value of trade between developing countries, in other words, South-South trade, overtaking developing country exports to the North. The rising influence of the emerging economies put an end to the preeminence of the industrialized countries. All the data, IMF, OECD, World Bank, strongly suggests to the rising impact of the developing and emerging economies. However, the industrialized countries are not prepared to concede. They embarked on two major initiatives, both in Atlantic and Pacific. So, the problem of WTO is more fundamental and more systemic than is than portrayed so far. Both initiatives are spearheaded by the US and obviously share the same coherent strategy, TTP and TTIP. Mind you, all the industrialist countries, with the exception of Norway and Switzerland, have seriously engaged with one of the two initiatives. Imagine the impact of the global trade system when the two partnership quests become a reality. Together, they represent roughly 2/3 of the global GDP and close to 50% of world trade. The articles of the agreements have the potential to be the base for universal implementation. Mainly, harmonization of regulations is considered to be the key elements to keep integration further. Thus, the construction of greater compatibility among rules implemented by the developed economies is deemed to be the fundamental goal of both initiatives. It is argued that this would mean a shift from international agreements to international harmonization agreements, where issues such as labor, environmental, so on and so forth have been taken. Geopolitical concentration will have a say in the new emerging system. However, the weight of the parties of the partnership agreements, though is undisputed fact, yet their potential to incite change in the multilateral system ultimately lies on the recognition of them by the third parties. TPP is concluded. Negotiations on TTIP are carried out. The presidential elections in the U.S. extended the negotiations time of the TTIP. The future of TTIP still remains uncertain, and this renders much of the analysis here a bit speculative. Nevertheless, all the developing countries will be confronted with the rules that are molded in their absence. 160 countries, thus 80% of the world population are excluded. Whatever. I think I should get a bit faster. Nearly all the chapters of the TPP carry rules that go beyond WTO arrangements, either in WTO plus or WTO extra format. TTP is expected to be more comprehensive. Is this reversible, or is it so? I don't know. We should not take the conclusion of TTIP for granted. The 13th round of negotiations proved that the great challenges are ahead of the trade negotiators. What we are witnessing in the developing West is a strong reaction against further integration. The three leading candidates for the US presidency all oppose TPP and the TTIP. Is it safe to assume that the U.S. and in Europe, political and intellectual climate has cooled towards the extension of trade deals like TPP and the transatlantic version, TTIP? How should the developing economies read these developments, and what will be the reaction of the G20? One of the options for the third countries is to unilaterally harmonize trade policies. A few words on what to do. I personally think that the concerns of the developing and emerging countries should not be reduced to merely trade diversion. The developing world will be kept out of the loop from the participating in the rulemaking process, thus reducing them to rule takers. This would not be an easy task in view of the China, Brazil, and India. the remaining three P countries of the P5. The developing countries should push for unilateral reforms and improve their level of the economies, ameliorate the climate of investment to draw in more FDI, devise policies to improve climate innovation. Secondly, underline the importance of WTO as a major platform in forging new rules are needed. The mega deals should be open to accession. This is number one. And secondly, plurilaterals under the umbrella of WTO would be a potential substitute, at least because WTO will give a legitimacy to the plurilaterals, and support of the WTO secretariat would be vital. Let me make some closing remarks. All developing countries need to get prepared for the inescapable power shift in geographical climate and seriously embark on unilateral transformation of their economies. They should be ready to undertake substantive legislative and institutional changes in several challenging areas, such as services sector, agriculture, intellectual property issues, and technical standards. On their part, the U.S. and the EU should consider TTIP and mega deals as facilitating steps to further liberalize the multilateral level, at the multilateral level. The game-changing rule should not be at the expense of the third parties. Last word, inclusiveness should be the key concept both within and outside of the realm of the mega deals. I think I should stop here. I've done enough.
Perfect. Thank you, Boskurt. That's, again, very substantive. And it takes us already into that question of articulating the multilateral trade system to the developments outside of it as a way of consolidating against the centrality of the WTO. Ronald Saborio, Ronald, you get the floor.
Thank you, Ricardo. Thank you very much. I'm very glad to be here. Some signals are written in the walls with huge capital characters. It is time to make the multilateral trade negotiations responsive to today's global trade. Two consecutive ministerial conferences delivering multilateral trade agreement is valuable, but not enough to claim victory over WTO multilateral trade negotiations constraints. Private and public trade actors continue to rely on other international trade negotiations contexts to find solutions to their needs and not very much into the WTO capacity to find them. Protectionism finds new ways much faster the monitoring mechanisms and rules to contain it. Least developed countries and low-income developing countries have minimal presence in PTA's negotiations and obtain very modest results on their proposals in multilateral trade negotiations. They have not obtained binding trade commitments from counterparts in some areas identified by them as crucial for their development. Trade and investment have a very unequal distribution among nations, LDCs being in the bottom. I will come back to some of these issues, but now I would like to emphasize on the importance of inclusiveness for the multilateral trading system to consolidate and to be able to build upon the results of the ministerial conference in Nairobi. Multilateral trade negotiations and their outcome must pay further attention to LDCs. LDCs in particular continue to be in a very disadvantageous situation in terms of integration to global trade, but also regarding multilateral negotiation practices, where their positions have, in fact, very limited incidence in substantive results. And I don't want to say that efforts have not been made to make negotiations more open to all members. Preparatory work under the TNC and the negotiating groups allowed in the past two ministerial meetings allowed to contribute to the negotiated results that were obtained. And in particular, in the stages prior to the ministerial meetings in Bali and then in Nairobi, allowed for an effort in which a wide group of countries participated. It was a very interesting combination of open-ended meetings under the Director General leadership and that of facilitators, for instance, and in the case of trade facilitation, or with negotiations in through consultations of various settings, which is necessary as well. Big players should have the possibility to interact among themselves and exercise leadership, combining this with transparency and a say from all members. And yes, WTO members delivered important results, both in Bali and Nairobi. And yes, the way is open for members to build on the results of Nairobi to strengthen the WTO and its multilateral negotiating capacity. These two past ministerials have been probably more exciting with their long nights and roller coaster predictions through the days and the unpredictable outcomes. But both Bali and Nairobi negotiations and certain results at some point in time entail very heavy risks for the WTO membership and the organization. So I very much believe that is not a model to continue reproducing in future negotiations. Important gaps existed when the conference was launched in Bali, and too much substantive work remained to be done in Nairobi. Furthermore, crucial parts of the negotiations were negotiating among small groups, and solutions were built around package deals on which those outside of the room did not have the same opportunity to defend their interest and be part of those completing the content and the wrapping of those packages. No wonder why the results reflect that limited set of results for LDCs. Results in both ministerial conferences show that when it comes to 11th hour negotiations, actually, no one represents the interests of those outside. As a matter of principle, no one but the LDCs should represent their own interest, and there is no other way. Those members, they had the chance to closely contribute to the shaping of results in Nairobi, should not always rely on the constructive attitude of LDCs who, in fact, accepted best endeavors as a result in important areas of interest. Not that small steps are not important, but requesting the poorest to take best endeavors as a result of trade negotiations while others obtained consistently binding commitments in the negotiations is probably not sustainable, nor is it commendable. LDCs must be part of all relevant talks and their interests addressed. Furthermore, all opportunities to deliver multilateral results in this house should have tangible, binding results for LDCs, which would contribute to comply with the development goals. And today after Nairobi, members have the whole spectrum, the whole savanna in front of them in terms of trade-related issues. They have the DDA, unfinished negotiating areas, and any other trade-relevant issues they may decide together to bring to the WTO. Would that mean that WTO should be the place for instance, investment, multilateral investment negotiations? That is not the discussion among members today. While countries have negotiated investment rules and new ideas have made the way to recent PTAs, and other proposals are part of current negotiations and will probably have an impact in rules on investment globally, many countries are not part of it and have not been part of it and may feel unsure of what it entails for them. Still, their opposition is linked as well to other considerations. And I believe that they link it in particular to the lack of substantive results in the past two ministerial meetings regarding their core issues. They lack confidence in the readiness of other members to walk the extra mile regarding some of their core interests in trade negotiations, such as rules of origin, services, cotton, or duty-free, quota-free. Trade and investment discussed together, being the subject of public policy design in an integrated manner, have brought the full potential of trade, including in developing countries. Those that know me from my past life know about my long commitment to make developing countries benefit from trade and benefit from foreign direct investment. But you will have to convince LDCs that it is being done in their interest. And you might not be in the best position to convince them about that. Michael Skapinker wrote in the Financial Times yesterday that leaders must go out and take society's temperature. He said that in reference to companies' need to be far more alert to the trends of their societies. Among these trends, the objection to inequality today stands out amongst the other. The lack of confidence in those in the driving seat is part of today's picture as well. Deutsche Bank, Renault, and BP's shareholders vote against those in the driving seat enjoying advantages is described by Skapinker as a defining moment in making those running the show to pay attention to interest of shareholders. I don't intend to compare big players in WTO negotiations with the tremendous advantages that some of these CEOs had. But while you enjoy support as G20 and recognition in your efforts to address global issues, the smaller players, and in particular LDCs, expect their needs to be addressed, perhaps in a more forceful way. And a number of you are part of the G5 in the negotiations in the WTO, in the G7, in the G12, in breakfast, informal meetings, and have a greater influence in the shaping of results. This feeling of societies and what they expect from leaders in these times of uncertainty is not very different, I believe, from the feeling of small players here, LDCs, low-income developing countries, in multilateral trade negotiations. So I believe that it's important not to wait for a vote or a lack of consensus, as it happened in the board of these companies. I think it's important to anticipate, and I insist, it's written in the walls in capital characters. Leaders must go out and take others' temperature. And today, I believe it indicates that inclusiveness in multilateral trade negotiation is necessary to obtain the engagement of all members.
Thank you, Ronald. That's a very clear message. Let me turn to Jean-Pierre now. We have time now getting tight. Jean-Pierre.
Thank you very much. I'm very pleased to be here. I have to give a warning that this is going to be a rather iconoclastic perspective. Whenever I come here recently, I feel terribly nostalgic about the good old days when there were protesters outside saying down the WTO, etc. And now, of course, we're more ignored. I'm a self-confessed angry old man. I've been around for a long time, 15 years. I've been watching the Doha round going nowhere. And I know it'll not finish in my lifetime, but I'm worried about my grandchildren's lifetime. And I think that one has to look at the situation to see that, in fact, there are some, in my view, some very, very fundamental problems. So a warning, this is rather iconoclastic. So firstly, I've compared the negotiating DDA with the myth of Sisyphus. Sisyphus was a figure of Greek mythology who was condemned by the gods to repeat forever the same meaningless task of pushing a boulder up a mountain only to see it roll down again. And I think this encapsulates in many ways what's been going on over the course of the last 15 years. And I think one of the things that I've argued a lot when we were in the Evian group was why? What are the fundamental issues rather than working at the edges? And one of the explanations, possible explanations I find was in a book by Jean-François Richard, some of you may know, where he says basically what you see is that if you take change and if you take time, and over the course of the, say, 1980s, early 1990s, change in technologies and markets was linear. Then all of a sudden, round about the early 1990s, mid-1990s, change in technologies and markets became exponential. So Dennis talked about all these new technologies that have come in. Markets, I mean, we had, if you take China, for example, the 80s was feeling the stones as you're crossing the river. Then all the sense about the mid-1990s, China's role in international trade increases quite dramatically. Now, this is what's happened at the level of institutions, what's happened at the level of markets, technologies. The world has changed a lot. WTO hasn't. Institutions tend to continue in a linear fashion. Mentalities tend to continue in a linear fashion. And he identifies this governance gap, which I believe is one of the issues that is stalling the progress. The ambassador said that the G20 is a boat. He's right. The point is that I think it's not necessarily a pleasant leisure trip. There's a lot of fighting. And the thing is that this is not the G20. This is the G7. Why do we have the G7? Why? Why? What's the point? It's an insult. And if you look at the G7, in fact, there's a vast majority of Europeans. All of them are going to be at the G20 meeting. This doesn't make any sense. I think, among other things, the other countries should insist. If India has won, China has won, US has won, Europe won. We don't need all these crowds. As a Frenchman, I can assure you, G20 will be much happier without François Hollande. So this is part of the problem, is that we don't, this is the institutions, they're still there. And I think that, as I say this as a European, Europeans are a major break to progress in global governance. And we've got to get rid of the G7 and have the G20 more adapted to the 21st century than to the 19th century. I'm sure everybody agrees. So one of the issues that arises why this G20, in my opinion, and global governance in general is not moving forward, that there's a very fundamental problem of communication. And I put up the Cancun logo here, that's the Tower of Babel. I went to Cancun in 2003, and I thought this is not going to work. And I can prove it because I wrote from Cancun saying there was no common wavelength. And there's not only no common wavelength, but very combative language. Very mercantilistic in attitude. We've got problems. The world is evolving. We have changes that are taking place that are unprecedented, and yet we're fighting on, I'll give you this concession, if you give me that concession, it's on. Come on! And I left very, very angry after Cancun, and things have not particularly improved. So we can get on together, but I think the point that you were making, or I think is Boskurt, it's at the top level. I mean, I know whatsoever that in the WTO, the negotiators can find means of being on the same wavelength, but at the political level, it's absolutely not taking place. So I think the WTO has stalled partly because there's been a huge problem of communication, lack of goodwill. I think the fact, by the way, that the Doha development agenda, has not been completed is a huge indictment of the leadership of the 21st century. Huge indictment. And partly it arises again from the fact that we have very atavistic attitudes and problems of communication. Comments have been made about the alternatives. I'm shocked by the some of the language being used in terms of the mega regionals. And when Obama said, we can't let, this is quotation straight, you've probably heard it, we can't let countries like China write the rules of the global economy, we should write those rules, Barack Obama. Come on, what about writing them together? Why wasn't he criticized, except by me, by other leaders, saying this is not the, this is not, should not be the way we move forward in the 21st century. Then to make matters worse, his defense secretary, Ash Carter, says, you may not expect to hear this from the Secretary of Defense. Right, we shouldn't. But in terms of our rebalance in the broader sense, passing TPP is as important to me as another aircraft carrier. Imagine if the Chinese Minister of Defense said that. Imagine. I mean, this is. I think, how can we progress when we have this kind of rhetoric and this kind of mentalities, which are very, very, very. This is also taken from Jean-François Richard. I think I'm going along with what Dennis Noor was saying, the needs of inclusiveness, the need of approaching coherence, cohesion. You know, we have problems with the climate change, the planet, with our humanity, and with our rule book. And he suggests that we have to look at these inclusively together and move forward on an agenda that is a true global agenda of global development. I don't know about you guys. I'm very worried. I think things are going in the wrong direction, and we need to be much more aware of the dangers that lie ahead. So, Nicolas, I fully agree with you. We need Chinese leadership. I need Chinese leadership because, and I hope it's going to be manifested not just at the G20. And I give a quotation from Cheng Xinwei, the late thought leader, Chinese thought leader, politician, economist, a wonderful guy, great friend. He always used to say, China needs the world needs China. And this is true. One of the things that I comment, remarks that I often make is when comparing China with other superpowers like the US, China's very fragile. 18% of the world's population, 7% of the arable land. It needs the world. It needs to be able to get access, etc. The U.S. can be much more self-contained. A Chinese Trump is unimaginable. Mind you, Trump is unimaginable also. But anyway, it's just not feasible. China needs the world. The world needs China. So we need Chinese leadership. And now, maybe I should leave before I show the last slide. This is something that I've argued for some time, and it's a way of introducing Stuart, that I think, and I know I'm going to be hated for this, I've said it before, I think the WTO should move out of Geneva. There's too much of a bubble. It's too inward looking, and it's too near the European Union. So I strongly favor Hong Kong as a new location of the WTO as a means of progressing in the 21st century and making it closer to China to assume its leadership. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Jean-Pierre. We turn immediately to Stuart Harbinson. Stuart.
Thanks very much, Ricardo.
Sword, you need your mic.
Sorry.
Well, I mean, and also, I would say, like Jean-Pierre, I'm prone to nostalgia, although I don't think I'm quite as angry as he is. But it's an interesting fact, looking back over the many WTO ministerial conferences I've attended, that the most disastrous conferences are the most fun, you know? Seattle was a blast. So there's food for thought in that. Anyway, what I thought I would do is that, given that we were given a very long list of questions in the introduction for this session, I just thought I would pick on four issues very briefly and go through them. So this is certainly not a complete presentation, but there were four points that I wanted to address. First of all, how to build on Bali and Nairobi and inject new momentum. Secondly, making the WTO more relevant to business. Thirdly, the G20 and WTO decision making in negotiations. And fourthly, the G20 role in trade negotiations. So those are my four topics. And I'll start with the first, which is how to build on the Bali and Nairobi momentum. Of course, I don't think anybody has got a magic prescription for this or a list of deliverables. That would be crazy at this point in time. But I've been trying to think about the issues and how we can start to refine the menu, as it were, so that in due course we can get some decent deliverables for the next ministerial conference. And I've got a few things which you might describe as guiding principles, to use to borrow terminology from APEC and the G20. But of course, these are just my suggestions for your consideration. First principle, avoid the Doha, non-Doha discussion. Recognize that many Doha issues remain highly relevant, while many others have been pending too long. So don't get hung up on the Doha, non-Doha thing. Let's not get sidetracked by that. Second point, have a framework narrative that can attract different constituencies and be inclusive. Think about the idea of convergence. Negotiations and issues should lead to a greater convergence in incomes and living standards of all members, and to greater convergence on global trade rules. This narrative should also, in my view, make reference to the Sustainable Development Goals. GATT and the WTO have both been convergence mechanisms, but recently this role is being assumed by mega-regionals. But mega-regionals cannot be a global convergence mechanism. So there is room for the WTO to move into this space. Fourthly, let the issues emerge from the members. Those issues which have sufficient support will make it to the agenda, others won't. In other words, define by doing. Don't start off negotiating a work program or anything like that. Just have a menu, a reasonably balanced menu of issues, and see what can be accomplished. I think if we proceed that way, sort of informal, inbuilt WTO mechanisms will always ensure that there's a reasonable balance, that there are issues on the table of interest to everybody. Fifthly, look for areas to negotiate, both Doha issues and non-Doha issues, where there is space for reforms which will not cause too much opposition domestically, because there's considerable public opposition now in many countries to big trade deals. So we need to look at a more grained level to see where there is space to move without creating too many waves. This might mean taking slices out of subjects, not dealing with a particular subject in its entirety at one go. It might mean that we need incremental progress. So in my view, in the current climate, modest is good in terms of outcomes, but still meaningful, of course. And sixthly, encourage members to focus on real commercial interests rather than ideology. We need more pragmatism. And this is particularly the case when it comes to non-Doha issues. Let's face it, it's going to take a long, long time to work up some of these non-Doha issues, new issues like investment, digital trade, into anything like a negotiating framework. So, but we must make a start. We don't know, we can't define the issues, we can't say whether we want to move ahead or not unless we start. So we must be open-minded to doing this in the WTO, because if we don't do it in the WTO, it'll be done elsewhere. Moving on quickly to my second point, which is how to make the WTO more relevant to business. You know, the business community, and I've had quite a lot to do with it over the years, has an inbuilt preference for multilateralism. Companies don't like to have to deal with this multiplicity of different rules and regulations, rules of origin, etc. And small companies can't cope with it at all. I think a study by the WTO Secretariat a few years back showed that the utilization rate of a lot of FTAs was rather low, simply because companies can't do that. Some bemoan the absence of business from the WTO, kind of, you know, it's two sides of the same coin, business is not here. But business is not here talking to delegations and presenting their case often because they don't think anything's going to happen. As soon as business smells a deal, they will be back. I think the recent dialogue that we heard about with business leaders last week was a very good starting point to kind of try to reconnect. The business leaders acknowledged that there are many issues, many Doha issues are still of interest to them, but they also wanted to discuss other areas that require the WTO to work on them. Interestingly, the feedback I got from one or two of the business attendees last week is that the response from the delegates was tepid. That was the word that was used to me, tepid. So, you know, I wasn't there, so I don't know if it's true. But, sorry, I think I'm sabotaging the machine. I'm obviously not very au fait with the technology in this building these days. I would add also that I think the elephant that is not in the WTO room at present, as regards business, is trade in services. This is a huge, huge area of the world economy now. And there will be a whole new wave of business interest if we can find a way of bringing services back in a meaningful way to the negotiating table. Of course, this is related to the Trade in Services Agreement and what's going to happen to that. So it's crucial, I think, that the Trade in Services Agreement or parts of the Trade in Services Agreement are brought into the WTO for further negotiation. And I think then you will find business will be here in a flash. Delegates, in their turn, need to show more interest in connecting with the real world to negate the impression that the WTO operates in a bubble. which I think some of the previous speakers have referred to. Thirdly, a very quick word, if I may, on the G20 and WTO decision making, because I'm a bit of a heretic on this issue. We've seen in G20 declarations, I think in Brisbane and in Antalya, that the G20 leaders appear to be worried about the WTO. They want to find ways of making it more effective, making it work better. They talk about the WTO as if it's a kind of sick institution. They talk about the WTO as if it's a broken piece of machinery. This, in my view, is very, very far from the truth. The record shows that whenever the political will is there in the WTO, I should say here in the WTO, the deal gets done. And the WTO members and the secretariat are very clever about identifying all sorts of techniques as a platform to produce the deal. Trade Facilitation Agreement, ITA, going back telecoms, financial services, more recently export competition. So the problem is not the institution, far from perfect as it is. Of course, I can't say that the WTO is a perfect institution. The problem is actually the G20 members. They can't agree on the substance of issues, and that is reflected in the institution. So I think for the G20 to embark on a discussion of WTO governance and decision-making is really the wrong way to go. I don't think this is going to be productive at all. I think G20 countries would do better to concentrate on national policy coherence. Finally, have I still got time, Ricardo? Okay. Well, the G20 role in trade negotiations, hugely beneficial, of course, that G20 leaders get together and actually discuss trade in the WTO. That's fantastic. Institutionalization of the trade ministers' meeting and the trade and investment working group, excellent also. Think it's important to recognize that this huge undertaking can't produce instant results, especially given the diversity of its membership. So expectations and targets should usually be moderate, and that applies to trade as well. Being overambitious in too specific a sense can sometimes be counterproductive. For example, the 2010 G20 commitment to bring Doha to a swift conclusion, ha ha. So I think the emphasis should be more on medium to long-term confidence building in trade. I'm going to skip over a few points now because I think I'm running out of time. I would just sort of conclude, I think, that if I can find my conclusion, that given the background, trade slowdown, mega-regionals, much touted, we've all heard it. Well, you know, the contrast between the paralysis in this place and the success of mega-regionals. But mega-regionals, some of them are not moving. TPP is not moving. Yeah. TTIP is not moving. Yeah. And even FTAs in place are underutilized. So trade slowdown, mega-regionals in trouble, public opinion hostile to big deals in many, many countries. But the G20 still needs a new policy response to stimulate growth and jobs. We're running out of options, basically. So maybe, I leave this as a final thought, maybe this is the time, you know, that the WTO can come back a little bit more to the center stage. Because the WTO, if it operates, as I was saying, through partial deals, incremental deals, piecemeal deals, not big packages, you know, this could be the way to go, the path of least resistance. I leave that thought with you. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much, Stuart. Let me suggest we close at 11:10, given that we started a bit late, because I do want to hear it at least from the public at least one or two comments, if anybody would like to take the floor. Okay. Alejandro, please. There you go. could introduce yourself to the audience, please.
I'm Alejandro Jara. I'm with the law firm King & Spalding. I came very late, just at the end of Jean-Pierre Lemann's intervention. So I apologize, but I'm very interested in Stuart's comments, and I wanted to ask a question. When he says that perhaps one thing that should be done is to bring services back into the WTO, because the action is not taking place in the WTO, do you think that it makes sense to bring services back into the WTO without doing something about investment governance, at least investment in terms of market access commitments, et cetera? And I personally think that it doesn't make sense to do one without the other at this point in time, and I think that that would be very welcome and very attractive to business.
Thank you, Alejandro. Anybody else like a comment rather than a question, if you have one? Jean-Paul.
Yes, thank you very much, Jean-Paul Thuyer, French permanent representative to WTO. Well, actually, one question to Ronald Saboglio-Soto with regard to the place and the role and the interests of least developed countries in a view of full integration from those members in the multilateral trading system. It's always difficult to talk on behalf of least developed countries. And one question with regard to the preparation of Nairobi and further, in my view, was the difficulties of least developed countries to appear as able of defining openly in all the open session of preparation their own interest, including within the group of developing members, including within the talks inside the G90, including inside in the talks on the Committee of Trade and Development in special session. And we knew that there were as well tensions between the developing country group and in my view it would be something to reflect upon. Within the LDCs, the best way for them to make their point and appear as being more assertive within the trade negotiations. Thank you.
Thank you, Jean-Paul. Just one more, please.
Thank you, Ricardo, and thank you to everybody on this panel. I'm Claudia Locatelli, and I'm working at the WTO Secretariat in the Trade and Services Division, Trade and Service and Investment Division, actually, I should add. And so I'm very happy to hear that what Stuart said, indeed, that services are key. Now, my question would be, I mean, to all, but in particular to Stuart, I think you said that we should look for areas when the negotiations, where areas that are ready, where there's space for reforms. I mean, areas where, in a sense, liberalization is already ongoing, and there is areas that are low-hanging fruit, so to speak, where actually a multilateral deal could be achieved. And of course, it's true that WTO has very rarely produced liberalization. In fact, it has harvested existing liberalization, typically the basic telecoms. So, what areas would you see for that today? Have you identified any areas that could be such low-hanging fruits, even though they too low-hanging fruits are probably not worth to have, but if you have maybe ideas.
Okay, thank you, Claudia. Okay, well, let me try to, yes, one more, and then we come back.
Thanks, Chairman. Yeah, I have a little comment, and I'm impressed by the first speaker's speech. They mainly focus on the WTO and have referred to the topics we will be discussing in the next session, that is FTA, the relationship between the FTA and the WTO. And we all think that WTO is important, and we need action and something to make, to put forward it. But how? And G20 is a hope, but it's controversy. So besides G20, how we can make WTO members to unite to make the DDA negotiation complete? I think we should think that who should be the leaders, the US, the EU, or the Chinese. Thank you. Yeah.
Okay. Well, this is very interesting. I mean, we heard a panel that came out with very profound reflections on the situation today with the global trade investment system, some more specific ideas on content, particularly of what needs to be discussed and what is critical to the WTO. But as you see from the questions and the comments from the audience, this is a very pragmatic and maybe because we are in the WTO, it's a very pragmatic audience, and they want to hear it about more specifics. You want to know where do we go from here, and what is it that you're proposing that would lead us to where we want to go. I think on the last comment from our Chinese colleague helps me in a way move the conversation on the agenda that we have. I think we should take up issues related to RTAs and the coherence of RTAs and the WTO perhaps in the next session as well. And then the questions related to services and investment, particularly we have a session in the afternoon that has been designed to focus on that. So I'm going to give the floor 2 minutes to each of you to give us some concluding remarks. But before that, let me just take a couple of minutes also to tell you what I think very, very generally about some of the things that have been said. Keep in mind that I have yielded my time to all of you. So I'll try to be very, very, very brief as well, and knowing that we're against time. So the first thing is that it's clear that the big concern that we all have is has to do with the structure of the global trade and investment system being grounded in principles, but really made up of very diverse arrangements, highly diverse arrangements. Realizing that that's the case and that we have to deal with complexity, knowing that there is a big desire to have interoperability among the various pieces of that system. The question is, where do we go, and particularly, what is the role of the WTO in that context? And I think that's the underlying sort of concern that comes out from all the presentations. Is it coherence? Is it convergence? We pledge for coherence, but if you're not specific about the mechanisms that lead to coherence or what you really mean by coherence, then it becomes a very empty word as well. And that the G20, as I was saying before, have this competitive advantage to provide guidance, for instance, on that questions of on those questions of interoperability, but also of coherence. Those should be perhaps some of the focuses that the G20 could, as it works towards the future in learning more how to interact with the trade system, could keep high in mind. I think it was Stuart that mentioned convergence. Convergence is also it's a very interesting idea. It can take you down to, for instance, in a race to the bottom, which is it's convergent. It's also coherent, but it could also take you up in a race to top. What kind of convergence is it that we're looking at, and what should guide that convergence? So, a study came out last week that was featured in the Financial Times, for instance, on convergence with respect to income per capita and other indicators of some people are calling prosperity around the world. And what we know is that past the last crisis, the trends of convergence with respect to income per capita, so how many countries are at a certain level, say, of income per capita compared to the U.S. economy, for instance, has changed dramatically. And some people think that those hopes that we had before the crisis, that we were going towards better convergence in that respect are now lost. So it is in that context again that we need to think about what kind of references do we need really to guide those questions of how to promote, again, the interoperability of the different parts, the articulation of the different parts of the global trade investment system, the coherence between its rules, the response to those principles, and then harnessing the whole architecture, the frameworks, to those objectives now of sustainable development and Agenda 2030. Those, I think, are the sort of the high questions that really should be posed to leadership and to the G20. Jean-Pierre is very fond of Jean-François Richard, the ideas in High Noon. If I remember well, High Noon was a speech that he gave in 2002 at the World Economic Forum before turning it into a book. It was 20 problems and 20 years to deal with them. And we're now in 2016. And many of them, as you said, continue to be very current. Again, what we need to, what we need to do from here is help propose an agenda to the leadership that looks at those big questions. What are the big questions in front of us, really? And then how do we work with them from a global perspective? The issues of what do we need in this house, specifically post Nairobi, to take the WTO forward, well, they have to be dealt with here in the WTO. I think one of the messages that come out from this morning's remarks is that inclusiveness is a very high important in that respect. Again, we'll come up to in the next sessions to discuss in more detail those things related to content in the agenda, how to bring into the WTO, or rather the WTO into the 21st century of the digital economy, some of the issues that Professor Snower has outlined, and some of the others. The issue of investment and trade coherence, which is absolutely critical for this house, is not just the review of the very fragmented and incredibly inefficient and now ineffective system that we have for international investment, but the coherence with trade rules. How do trade rules really relate to investment today and investment to trade in a world where again, services and goods and investment come more and more together? How to deal with questions of, it wasn't mentioned here, but it's very much in the minds of everybody. What do we do with rules related to overcapacity, to subsidies, to the question of revenues, to the green agenda? Can we package those in a way that there would be trade-offs in this house that we can take forward in an agenda here? What to do with agriculture, and the issues that are pending there? Can we turn the focus here to a systemic view of agriculture that takes into account food systems, again, and that looks into the complexity of the relation between the production of agricultural commodities and food, going through processing, value chains, and again, issues related to infrastructure and so on. So all those things we can take up more in detail in this as we move forward here now and in other work in this house. But I'd like to bring back the emphasis here, which should be on the G20 guidance to the global trade and investment system, and again, how to help the WTO in that respect find its way in that new complex system. I'll go back to the panelists in an inverse order and start with Stuart. If you have 2 minutes, Stuart, to give us some remarks.
Thanks, Ricardo. I'll pass in view of the time. I think you've summed up very well indeed. Anyway, thank you.
Jean-Pierre?
Well, I'll take Stuart's time. No, just quickly, I think, you know, we agree the DDA is stalled. I fully agree with those, and particularly Stuart's comments, saying that the mega regionals are stalled. Where are we? And one of the questions I have is, are our expectations about the G20 realistic? Do we know whether has a G20 ever delivered? So we say G20, G20, G20. I'm very skeptical about what the G20, how is trade on the agenda in the G20? What are they going to be talking, what length, and so on and so forth? But having said that, I think it's an absolutely key challenge. Somehow or other, we've got to get, is your question, who, I don't know, but the political leadership has to be behind the revitalization of the multilateral trading system, because we're operating in a void, and this is very dangerous.
Bruno?
Thank you, Ricardo. Let me try to answer in a very brief manner to your very interesting question about developing countries and their groupings. I might not be the best person to answer to that question, because I never understood some of these groups, actually. I have to say in favor of the least developed countries that they have been quite coherent over time. And I made reference to the past two ministerials, and they have signaled some specific elements that are core issues for them. It is true that they have been part of Christmas trees or letters to Santa with many other things. But I think that's the result of not being involved in the negotiations. You bid for a longer list to obtain a smaller list, but they come to the same result that they don't obtain. So I wouldn't characterize them into that. The rest, I think that they did not choose to be ordering those groups. The G90 is a funny, interesting definition of, what is it, beneficiaries of EU past policies? What is the G90? I really don't understand it. I respect them, I take their views, but they have to be taken as what they are historically. And very often we tend to make groupings to simplify things. And with all respect to developed countries, you make too much of these groupings. And making a big group of very different individuals only demonstrates ignorance of the specificities of those individuals. It's a cognitive process of our brain. The human brain tends to group to facilitate learning. The more you understand one developing country, the more you understand one group, you realize how different they are. While there are some common constraints, they have limitation, financial limitation. You can imagine landlocked. There are some elements that you can define. But I think that you touch a crucial point. We need to see developing countries also in their need. When the Green Room was converted from a group of countries that were arbitrarily chosen to attend the meetings, Green Room is by definition arbitrary, it has always been. But it was changed from one group in which members have to justify their presence by bringing a specificity, something different, and commit to try to find solutions. It was changed from that to a group in which all developing countries groups are represented, even if one replicates the positions of the other, and you have them many times repeated, and less representation of ideas. And I believe that very often we put a straitjacket on them. We put a straitjacket on those belonging to those groups to express their interests. And this is why in Idea Center we try to take the individual members, take their needs, take their goals, take their constraints, and go from down from the national situation and from there up to the identification of policies that may save their goals and that would come to Geneva, and not the other way around, which is what we tend to see. Create a group and expect them to be coherent.
Thank you, Ronald. Oscar?
Well, two or three remarks. First of all, on the Chinese leadership, I need to tell you, as we were centuries, millenniums of years of contact with the Chinese, they don't take hasty decisions. Of course, it is understandable that this could be proposed. But mind you, they have built the Great Wall, the only structure that can be seen from the space. But instead, most of the countries, most of the races would have built big armies and go abroad. But they have built that, so that's a decision, defensive mostly. I mean, it takes time for them to make a decision, and that decision, I don't know, maybe has come, maybe has not. They are number one exporter, but second biggest economy in the world. The fragmentation issue. I mean, it is obvious that the fragmentation is there, and the multilateral system is not working. So instead of opposing the fragmentation totally or reject them as a systemic issue, maybe the fragmentation could be controlled or manageable. And how? This is a plurilateralism. And that should be somehow in our minds. And when it comes to pluralism, it could be a platform. And WTO could be an element, a venue to be worked with. That's what I wanted to say. And the convergence would become much easier if a multilateral platform would be ideal for, I don't know, this is what I think. And lastly, now the time is coming short, of course. I mean, we are having these meetings, all the bright guys, all bright minds come together, and they give their ideas. But at the end, and we must think that there are how many months before the Chinese T20 will get a report card? And how many of these ideas would be in the leaders' the declaration, and that will be the report card, and the time is running short.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Professor Snower.
Okay, I've been listening attentively to all the remarks here, and here's a response that lies sort of orthogonal to everything that's been said so far. We've heard a lot about the big questions. Jean-Pierre has given us a list. We look at the G20 as a large grouping that can look at these big questions in terms of the global public interest. And then we see difficulties of fragmentation that you've talked about. We live in a world that is increasingly integrated economically, but politically and socially, we remain fragmented. And as long as we retain our current groupings, this fragmentation will continue. Therefore, my question to you is, are we barking up the wrong tree? Are we asking the wrong questions? The questions that we've asked here are, what are the issues that we should look at in order to overcome this fragmentation? Maybe with the structure of thought that we have, there are no set of issues that will enable us to overcome the fragmentation, and making our ambitions more and more moderate will not lead to any big results. Perhaps we should focus on the groupings themselves. How did we arrive at the SDGs? We did not arrive at them by country groupings, nations sending representatives to make sure that their own interests are taken care of. Instead, we had a different set of groupings consisting of experts from around the world and representatives of people who are affected. And suddenly, we came up with a set of principles around which many others can rally. Maybe we should change the structure of our negotiations, not focus on the issues, but focus on the structure of the negotiations and the groupings that we have in there. If we look at big global problems, such as climate change, overcoming financial crises, and so on, clearly things that travel across national and cultural borders, maybe we should get some distance from the boundaries imposed by the nation state and instead focus on the global public interest and the groupings within it that we have in mind when considering these big global problems. And that, perhaps, is the big challenge ahead, finding groupings that will enable us to do global problem solving effectively.
Well, with that, let me thank you all for sharing with us a great deal of wisdom and experience. You all have participated in all these discussions for many years, and this is a debate that, of course, could take many more sessions to really get to some other conclusions. But we will continue during the day to look at some of the things that have been put on the table here. Thank you all. Thank you to the audience, and apologies for the delay in timing. Thanks.